Good morning. Welcome to worship. I invite you to turn to the brief order of confession and forgiveness in the front of the bulletin. Please stand. We begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all. Let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray. Holy God, through your Son, you have called us to live faithfully and act courageously. Keep us steadfast in your covenant of grace, and teach us the wisdom that comes only through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20. After escaping from slavery, the Israelites come to Mount Sinai, where God teaches them how to live in community. The Ten Commandments proclaim that God alone is worthy of worship, flowing from God. The life of the community flourishes when based on honesty, trust, fidelity, and respect for life, family, and property. God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is heaven above, or that is on earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, by showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and kept it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath day and the seventh day is a Sabbath to the daughter your to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, your son of your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien earth resident in your towns. For the 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, you shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord. Let us pray responsively. Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky proclaims its marker's handiwork.
One day,
although they have no words or language and their voices are not heard. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey of Rome.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Above all, keep your servants from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense. A reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The word of the cross is pure foolishness and nonsense to the world, because it claims that God is mostly revealed in weakness, humiliation, and death. But although such divine foolishness and weakness, God is working to save us. The center of Paul's preaching to Christ crucified. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discernment of the discerning I will thwart. There is one who is wise, there is the scribe, there is the debater of the age. Has not God made foolish of the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not proclaim, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, the Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness of Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to St. John in the second chapter. Jesus attacks the commercialization of religion by driving merchants out of the temple. When challenged, he responds mysteriously with the first prediction of his own death and resurrection. In the midst of a seemingly stable religious center, Jesus suggests that the center itself has changed. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scriptures and the word that Jesus had spoken." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. As we're moving through Lent, we have now reached a point where in the first lesson, the folks that compile the lectionary have been working through covenants. So we've had Noah, we've had Abraham, and now we have the summary of the covenant that God gave through Moses as a first lesson. The main lesson of the day, of course, is the gospel. And in John's gospel, he puts Jesus cleansing the temple right at the very beginning of his public ministry, whereas in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it's right at the beginning of Holy Week. I think one of the reasons for that is that John is much more theologically oriented in the presentation of the gospel that he makes. So he is not so much concerned with chronology as he is with theology. So for example, he only gives 7 signs at the beginning of his gospel to indicate who Jesus is, whereas in the other gospels, there's almost an unlimited number of exorcisms and healings and miraculous events and so forth. John's very careful. He'll say at the very end of his gospel that he didn't write down everything, but he picked things that would help you as the reader of his gospel come to believe that Jesus is the Christ. So there's that kind of an intentionality in John. And so I think his placing the cleansing of the temple at the beginning of the public ministry is to put things in focus, and most of his gospel will be that week that we call Holy Week. So what is Jesus doing going into the temple? So it's a huge facility. If you look at a map or pictures of Jerusalem today, you'll see that beautiful golden dome shrine that one of the early Muslim caliphs put up to commemorate the story of Moses or Muhammad's ascension into heaven. And that shrine is built over the place where the Holy of Holies was located when the Jewish temple was standing. That entire platform that you see in the pictures is about 10 or 12 football fields in size. So it's massive. When you see people praying at the so-called Western Wall or Wailing Wall of the temple, those are simply the stones that were part of the foundation of that platform. So when you think about that temple, the thing is huge. It's massive, and it was a beautiful building that when Jesus did this cleansing, they were 46 years into the construction of it, and it was covered in white marble and had gold trim, and it was just a magnificent facility. Jerusalem at the time was described as a temple with a town attached to it, so that people that worked at the temple had some place to live. there would have been, on a routine daily basis, tens of thousands of people coming and going out of that facility. The problem that worshipers would have is that if, for example, you wanted to go up to Jerusalem for presenting your firstborn male child and redeeming your son following the prescribed offerings in Leviticus, you'd need animals. So if you had them at your home and you walked dozens or maybe even a couple hundred miles to get to the temple, that, say, lamb that was looking really good when you pulled it out of the flock at home is now not eating normally, he's been walking a lot, losing weight, dirty from the road. And when you got to the temple, the priest could very easily go, that's not good enough of an animal to present to the Lord. So what people did was they left their own animals at home, they went to Jerusalem, and they purchased a already certified for sacrifice animal at the temple. Makes sense. Second problem, first commandment, no idols. You remember the story late in Jesus' ministry where they're trying to trap him, and they said, is it right to pay the poll tax to Caesar? And he said, show me the coin for the tax, and dug in their pockets and pulled out a denarii. He says, whose image is that? Well, Caesar's. He goes, okay, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. The real trick there, not only was Jesus fast on his feet, but he trapped his trappers, because you're not allowed to have pagan money in the sacred precinct of the temple because of the graven image on it. So he caught them violating the first commandment by just asking them for a coin. So if you're going to travel to Jerusalem and buy an animal, you can't use pagan money to do it. So you have to change your money. If you've ever traveled overseas, you know that dollars won't do you any good in Europe. You need euros. And so you've got to exchange your dollars. And they were doing that at the temple as a convenient for the worshipers. But how do you make money doing that? Well, you doctor the exchange rate a little bit so you're making a profit. And then, of course, you had to rent your license to have a stall in the temple. You had to pay that guy. And that guy had to pay the next guy. And pretty soon the exchange rates were exorbitant and the people were being fleeced. So whenever you have human beings and a symbol of exchange like money happening, it's going to creep upwards for profit for the people involved in it. And it's not much of a journey from a reasonable fee to extortion. And so that's what's happening in the temple. So part of what Jesus is doing when he goes up to the temple and makes a whip and he stampedes all these animals and overturns these tables and the money's flying and everybody's yelling and screaming, part of what's going on is there's now a disturbance of the peace in the temple. On one of the corners of the temple was a Roman fort called the Antonio, after Mark Antony, with Roman guards on the top of it, looking down into the temple, and no matter how much of a slackard those soldiers were, they would hear a civil disturbance of all these animals stampeding and people yelling and screaming. And the Romans' way of handling public disturbances is put on your armor, charge into the crowd, and kill everybody until the rioting stops. So Jesus has created this confrontation in the temple where there's the threat of the Romans coming in, the people are upset about the animals and the money and so forth, and then somebody from the bureaucracy runs up to Jesus and he goes, let's be reasonable. By what authority are you doing this? What sign can you do to prove that you've got the right to do this? That's the scene. Very dramatic. And quite frankly, doing that kind of thing would get you killed. So Jesus is standing there in this very poignant moment, and he did it on purpose. The first thing that he did was take charge of the entire facility. You shall not turn my Father's house into a marketplace. Whose house is it? Yahweh, the creator of heaven and earth. Jesus' Father's house. Who is Jesus? The designated, authoritative, representative, and person of God standing in their midst, laying down the rules about how it's gonna be. So he takes charge of the entire facility. The next thing that he does is reinterprets what's going on around his person. So if you've been paying attention as we've been studying Romans, one of the things that the author of the book we're using points out again and again and again is starting back at the Exodus with the giving of the Ten Commandments and so forth, God created, had Moses build this tent sanctuary called a tabernacle, and it's in three main rooms, with the very center room housing the Ark of the Covenant, and the seat on the top of the Ark of the Covenant is called the mercy seat, and the glory of God camps out there so that God is in the midst of his people. And it's been that way at Jesus' time for hundreds and hundreds of years. Been a transition where King Solomon built this temple instead of the tent tabernacle, but it's still the place where God is in the midst of his people. And what Jesus is doing in his public ministry all the way through is replacing the temple and the tabernacle before it with himself. The way in which God is in the midst of his people from the moment of the incarnation forward is Jesus of Nazareth. He is the living, sacred place where you find God. So he changes the conversation around that and says, my proof for doing this is destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll rebuild it. And they were like, it took 46 years. What are you, in the sun too much or whatever? And then they realized later that he wasn't talking about the building complex. He was talking about himself. And it's a full-blown, right from the beginning, detailed prophecy that the Messiah must come and suffer and die and on the third day raise from the dead. That's what's going on in this story. It doesn't end just with the resurrection. That is the vindication of Jesus of Nazareth. It's God showing in the most tangible way possible that Jesus is the second self of God, and that everything that he said and everything that he did and everything that pointed to him is true. And you can bet your life on him. Jesus said, I and the Father are one. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That's how this works. And so it doesn't just stop with his vindication. Jesus is continuing to move forward. And what he will do following the resurrection is review all of the teaching with his people, and then on ascension, he's physically taken from them. We don't see him in that way, and I'm going to say this on purpose, quite as often as they were at that point in time, though he does show up periodically in physical form throughout church history, but Jesus leaves us to be his witnesses in the world so that the good news of what God is doing is being carried out to everyone. And in order for us to be able to do that on the Feast of Pentecost, where they're celebrating the giving of the law that we read in the first lesson. The Holy Spirit is given to the church in general and to every one of Jesus' people in particular. And so the Christian is now a Holy Spirit-filled individual with a mandate from the Lord himself to be my witnesses. We are to carry the gospel forward in our lives and share it with everybody we possibly can. It's really good news, and they really need to hear it. That's what Jesus is doing. We, his people, hook into this story when we realize the going to the cross was completely intentional. It was God's plan going all the way back to the Garden of Eden. We've mentioned it several times and we'll keep saying it. Genesis 3:15, the so-called proto-evangelium. It's the first hint in Scripture of how God is planning on overturning the fall. Nothing is lost. Everything is made new. And Jesus will present all of creation to the Father, whole and complete, at the end of time. And life, the way God meant it to be before the fall, will now go forward. Our hope is, in the face of death, because we're Jesus' people, because he's given us the Holy Spirit, because he's promised us, we have real hope that we too will be raised from the dead, bodily, on this planet, with all of Jesus' people, living the life that God has intended from the beginning. So that's the big strategic hope. What do you do in the short term? Act like it's true. You don't have to hoard money. Your Father, who sees what you need and that you lay out in front of him when you pray in secret, will hear your prayers and bless you. You don't have to protect yourself from every scenario that could possibly ever happen, because you live in the palm of God's hands. There's a psalm that says, we are the sheep of his pasture and we live in his hand. God is your Father who has loved you from before the foundations of the earth, who called you into existence, who went to the cross to save you from the consequences of your sin, who gave you the Holy Spirit so that you might have life eternal. It's true. Live it. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks and praise for your obedience to the Father, for your coming to work the gift of salvation. Help us to live as Jesus people in the world, trusting in you, confident in you, bold in you. Amen.
confess our faith together with the words of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again, Lord, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the Church, the well-being of creation, and the world in need. You alone are God. We thank you for the gifts of the Sabbath rest. Awaken the Church to the mystery of your presence and give us glad hearts as we receive the good news of your deliverance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Your renew creation. Drive out those who would make the earth a marketplace. Protect rainforests, mountaintops, oceans, and wilderness areas from commercial exploitation. Unite nations, policymakers, and businesses in efforts to care for your creation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You judge the nations. We pray for an end to the war and strife in every land. Strengthen international efforts to negotiate peace and provide humanitarian aid to people fleeing from conflict. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You bring healing and hope. We give thanks for physicians, nurses, therapists, public health workers, and caregivers. We pray for any who are sick, especially Jessica, Gianna, Nelson, Don, Cecil, the family of Mike Miller, Terry, Pam, Carol, Gary, Mason, Donnie, Don, Marty, Frank, and Brenda, Greg, Ed, Brady, Cameron, Debbie, Mark, the Halter family, Brian, Katie, Shane, Jennifer, Fred, Janet, Carrie, Bobby, George and Kathy, Mary Ruth, Audrey, Greg, Ingrid, Angel, and Marcy. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You abide with your people. Sustain any in this community undergoing life transitions, marriage, divorce, childbirth, adoption, moving, graduation, employment change, or death in the family. We pray for those preparing for baptism. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You bring life from death. We remember our loved ones who have died, confident that they have new life in you. May we trust that nothing can separate us from your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
Let us pray. Jesus, you are the bread of life and the host of this meal. Bless these gifts that we have gathered that all people may know your goodness. Feed us not only with this holy food, but with the hunger, with hunger for justice and peace. We pray this in your name. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You called your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that, renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the very body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Bread for the journey, a feast for the hungry. Come. Thank you. Please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Let us pray. Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat are gathered into one bread, now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life.
Amen. I'd like to invite anyone that would like to receive prayer and anointing to join me in the front.
Thank you.
We stand for the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Loves you.